proven to be perfect. Only dozens special.
Yeah. Where's my coffee boy?
Yes, Mr. Jordan.
Thank you.
lobster delicious today.
Dear Mr. Potter,
We are safely home, so you have been accepted to go to school. You've got to what is it?
You're not coming, I tell you. We saw when we took him in, we put a stop to all this rubbish.
You knew. You knew all along and you never told him.
What? Now, what do you
want to do? Well, I
hope it's just a big one.
She went and got herself blown up. And then I landed with you.
Blown up? You told me my shirt died in a car crash.
A car crash? A car crash killed Lily and James Potter?
Say something.
It's an outrage. It's a scandal. You're not echoing.
And I suppose a great number like yourself's going to stop him, are you?
Michael.
My magic. This boy's had his name known ever since you were born. He's going to the finest school of witchcraft and wizardry in the world, and he will be under the finest headmaster that Hogwarts has ever seen. Albus Dumbledore. I'll not pay to have some crackpot old fool teach him magic tricks.
Diagon out.
you, Harry. You're famous.
But why am I famous? All those people like that. How is it they know who I am?
I'm not sure I'm exactly the right person to tell you.
Thank you. I wonder when I could see you.
I remember everyone that ever told me. It so happens that the phoenix, whose tail feather resides in your one, made another one. Just one. It is curious that you should be getting to this one. Then it's not enough. Say you that.
Who owns that one?
The one choosing the wizard is the puppet. It's not always here, the one.
I know who made kind of a fortune.
helmet like that, only cart and an evil trick for that. Well, someday you die. Hard to answer my thing. Nope. I'm going to do that next.
Bertie, what's every save of these? flavour. Chocolate and peppermint. And there's also spinach, liver and tripe. Big spread, it's got loads of flavours on there. These aren't real clogs, are they? It's just a spell. Science, it's the card you want. It's perhaps got a famous foot sort of wizard. I got back 500 from this year. Watch it! What a lot. I've only got one good jump in them to begin with. I've got Dumbledore. I got about 6 of him. Jesus God. Well, you can't expect him to hang around all day, can you?
He's a scabbard, by the way.
I bet he isn't. Fred gave me a spell as to turning yellow. What'd you say?
Yeah.
The house with the most points is awarded the house.
Come on!
ceremony will begin momentarily.
Hurry then. We're staying on the train. Harry Potter has come to Hogwarts. This is Crab. A Goyle.
Very good.
fake.
No, it's all here in your head. And Slytherin will help you on the way to greatness. And no doubt about that. No? Well, I'm not sure about it. Better be Gryffindor!
This is a super camera phone. Its super spectrum sensor finds light in the dark. Discover the Huawei P30 series.
Greetings and welcome to an LGR thing. And this thing is the OQO Model 02. Starting at $1,500 US for the base model and upwards of $2,300 fully equipped, the Model 02 was quite the exciting product when it launched in 2007. This from a specific point in the late 2000s where laptops, PDAs, smartphones, and netbooks were all in the market simultaneously, each fulfilling their own mobile computing needs. But the Model 02 was part of a new breed of device, the Ultra Mobile Personal Computer, or UMPC. The hype began with OQO's Model 01 all the way back in 2004, sporting an impressive sliding display revealing a physical keyboard and mouse underneath. The UMPC term hadn't even been coined then, but this was an early glimpse at what that would entail. A 1-2 punch of technical capability and small size. The OQO Model 02 arrived 3 years later with a similar form factor, but an even more impressive array of internal hardware, resulting in its claim to fame of being the world's smallest PC to run the latest feature-complete version of Windows. And it was introduced to the public by none other than Microsoft co-founder Bill Gates during his keynote address for the 2007 Consumer Electronics Show.
These were actually some full-blown Windows PC devices. You can even run the latest Windows business. You see this one taking your hand, and it's just a touchscreen device. Or this is more traditional in terms of the input.
Well, he kind of introduced it anyway. Mr. Gates didn't refer to the Model 02 by name, and calling it a touchscreen was a tad misleading. While the 02 did indeed feature capacitive controls for scrolling the screen vertically and horizontally, touching the screen itself won't do anything beyond accumulate fingerprints. Much like the Model 01 before it, the 02 featured an 800x480 magnetic field sensitive 5-inch LCD screen, requiring an additional $100 stylus pen accessory to interact with the panel directly. Otherwise, the Model 02 is simply an x86 compatible PC in a tiny form factor capable of running standard Windows software. And that was the driving force behind San Francisco-based OQO Incorporated, building computers with the capabilities of a laptop, but with the form factor closer to a PDA. Shame they didn't last very long, as you may deduce by the obscurity of the company today. Despite the planned Model 02 Plus making it pretty far into development, OQO never attained the level of profitability needed to stay in business, and they shut down in April of 2009. Curiously, a Model 03 popped up in 2010 from Chinese manufacturer Audiotone, but it turned out this was an unauthorized copycat device, and OQO had nothing to do with it. So yeah, well, things like the bootleg O3, the prototype O2 Plus, and the HSDPA Model E2 all existed in some form or another, what we're looking at today is the original Model O2. And this is courtesy of an LGR viewer named Joe. It's only on loan to me for this video, but I'm more than grateful for the opportunity, because these things are exceedingly elusive, especially in fully working order. Well, mostly working order. The handheld computers from the mid-2000s are a real toss-up in regards to usable lifespan, and this Model O2 is over the hill in that respect. For one thing, the sliding screen no longer holds like it used to, with the metal guide rails barely keeping it horizontally steady anymore, and the latching mechanism that once clicked the screen into place has long ago lost its strength. The screen protector was at least installed from the factory, so the plastic on the LCD is still nice and fresh. No word on whether removing it will cause half the screen to die or not, but you know, so far so good. Then there's the battery situation, or lack thereof, with the original 4,500 mAh lithium-ion polymer battery starting to bulge, no longer holding a charge or properly fastening to the back of the device. And lastly, the little 1.8-inch 4,200 RPM hard drive inside sounds like it's on the brink of death. While there was a 32 or 64 gigabyte SSD option available from OQO, it seems most opted for a hard disk instead. Makes sense for 2007 though, being that they were lower cost while offering nearly twice the storage at 60 to 120 gigs. The exhaust fans are also impressively loud, but that seems to have been an issue since launch, according to the reviews from back then. Yeah, it's not even doing anything that intense. It's just copying files from a thumb drive. You sure wouldn't expect the O2 to sound so much like a hairdryer. This thing is loud. The same, unfortunately, cannot be said for the audio, with its internal speaker barely cranking out enough sound to cover up the whirlwind of fan noise. Oh well, it still runs for the time being, so let's see what it can do. Starting with the keyboard, which is a nifty 58-key thing reminiscent of the Blackberries and Sidekick phones of that era. The keys are rather close together and understandably tiny, so it takes some getting used to, further complicated by all the stuff that's moved around to use with the function key. On the other hand, it has an actual numpad, so I can forgive the rest for most applications. And it's even backlit when the ambient light sensor detects darkness, a handy feature for those late-night computing sessions on the go. Then there's the track stick, as they called it, which is the mouse. Somewhat similar to the track point mouse on IBM ThinkPads, in that it doesn't spin around and stays in place to be nudged along the x-axis. The two largest keys over on the other side are the left and right mouse buttons, a pretty natural place for your left thumb anyway, so that makes sense. Along the bottom of the unit are a couple of nice surprises, including a full-size USB 2.0 port, the charging port slash docking connector, an air cooling vent, a full-size HDMI output port, and a 3.5mm headphone jack. Not to mention Bluetooth 2.0, so you can even connect wirelessly to a modern smart device and transfer data that way, in addition to the physical connection. So yeah, expansion options are legit on the O2, with USB accepting hubs, so you can plug in all sorts of things, and HDMI allowing you to plug in displays of resolutions of up to 1900 by 1200. This, of course, defeats half the purpose of having such a small system to begin with, but it's still a way more compact option than expanding a laptop, and way more capable than expanding a PDA. There was also this neat-looking docking station that OQO sold alongside the O2 that really makes it look like something from the future. A mid-2000s future, but still, it looks awesome. I don't know what it is, but I dig the aesthetic of oddly suspended components like this. Anyway, that's about it for physical stuff. The right side doesn't have anything, the top doesn't have anything, the left side just has the power button, security slot, and the battery release. Oh, I almost forgot, there is this little antenna that folds out, giving you better reception, both for the integrated 802.11g Wi-Fi and also for the optional EVGO mobile broadband service. Yep, this could also connect to a cellular provider like Verizon or Sprint, making it not only a UMTC, but also an MID, or mobile internet device. Yeah, that was a class of computer too, for a moment in time at least. Late 2000s mobile boom was nuts. And in case you're curious, yes, the Aerial does actually improve reception. I got about twice the bandwidth with it out, although it didn't come close to reaching my 200 megabit connection speed either way. In fact, nothing on the Model O2 runs as quickly or smoothly as you'd hope, and for several good reasons. The first is that it was never that speedy to begin with. It relies on a VIA C7M ultra-low voltage CPU, running at between 1.2 and 1.5 GHz. And in the days before the Intel Atom, this was a fine choice for a tiny PC in 2007, but it's still much slower than even laptop processors at the time. By some performance benchmarks, it's about on par with a 600 MHz Intel Celeron. Then consider its single gigabyte of RAM while also running Windows Vista, not to mention the poor hard drive on its last legs, and it's a little wonder why it's chugged. Yet even if it had an SSD and another gig of RAM, Vista clearly isn't the best choice for the O2's C7M chipset. It can't even run the Aero Glass interface due to the integrated VX700 graphics, so it's no surprise the O2 originally didn't come with Vista at all. You might have noticed this sticker underneath for Windows XP Tablet PC Edition, and yeah, that's what the early units understandably had pre-installed. Too bad this one now runs Vista then, because the potential here is excellent for some late 90s to mid-2000s gaming. I mean, it's a handheld computer that handles Quake 3 and Unreal without breaking much of a sweat. That's still pretty impressive in my mind. Not that the mouse, nub, and cramped keyboard are suitable for much of anything in terms of first-person shooters, but what you gonna do? And the 5-inch LCD is a respectable dimension for mobile gaming even today, with the overall size, shape, and design kind of reminding me of the PSP Go from 2009. The O2 screen really is a lovely transflective panel that's nice and bright, though not bright enough to consistently overcome the glare from the glossy plastic with or without the screen protector. And it gets worse, with the biggest setback in terms of the display being how it handles resolutions beyond its native 800x480. It's fine with lower resolution, but anything higher results in a zoomed-in image controlled by the mouse cursor, meaning that games like SimCity 4 fall apart with its minimum resolution of 800x600 and reliance on edge scrolling. And of course, the CPU and graphics chipset combo aren't enough even for games from 2005, with titles like Fear refusing to start up at all. And no, it does not run Crysis, though I certainly tried to force it anyway out of sheer curiosity. Most games beyond 2005 refused to start at all due to the graphics chip, with the newest one I got running being Flatout 2 from 2006. Well, that was not pretty. Yeah, this means that beyond productivity applications, the O2 is best suited to older PC games and various emulators in terms of performance capability. For example, PCSX runs PlayStation 1 ISOs at a respectable speed, depending on the game in question. It's nothing to write home about, but compared to Windows PDAs at the time, this was crazy impressive stuff. And DOSBox runs pretty well too when configured properly, so games like Commander Keen and Doom are right at your fingertips. So again, that keyboard is the largest constraint, especially when playing older games that use Control, Alt, and Shift. Those keys are actually toggle keys on the O2, meaning that you press them once and it keeps the button held down so you can then press something else. I guess that's one way to get an auto-fire button. No turbo gamepad required. But yeah, no. The Model O2 was unsurprisingly not built for gaming in any respect. The keys are just too tiny, and the mouse is just too nubby to result in anything beyond a few minutes of novel fascination followed by finicky frustration before you give up and go back to web browsing. Not that the internet performs much better, at least on the modern web. Websites and browsers have only gotten more complicated and memory intensive, and the O2 is, once again, not equipped to handle most of them. Even performing searches takes oodles of patience to endure, and multimedia sites like YouTube are sheer torture, even on lower video settings. Despite the limitations, though, I can't help but think about how the O2 was so close to being my ideal mobile device back in 2007. Yeah, I was all about things like PDAs, smartphones, and netbooks back then, having owned an iPad Pocket PC, a BlackBerry Pearl, and an HP Mini 1000 netbook. When combined, they met all my mobile wants and needs, but I always dreamed of having a more capable handheld device. Had I been able to afford an OQO Model 2 and actually seen one sold in stores, I totally would have been tempted enough to grab one back then. Instead, I completely missed out on the UMTC train of the late 2000s, only remaining passively curious about later devices like the GPD Win and similar Windows palm tops. But really, once I got my first touchscreen smartphone in 2011, well, I've never fully looked back. Except for when I cover things like the Model O2, that is. And I hope you've enjoyed looking back with me at this fascinating footnote in portable computing history. Once again, I hope you had fun checking out this piece of obscure tech. If so, you're on the right channel. I love making videos like this, and there are new videos weekly, so consider subscribing if you please. And as always, thank you very much for watching LGR. John McAfee virus scan, a program which quickly became a leading solution for protecting computer users from malicious code, resulting in McAfee and his company seeing huge success while jump-starting the entire antivirus software industry. But nowadays, you'd be hard-pressed to find anyone that willingly uses the software, and the man himself has been accused of everything from running a drug trafficking ring to raising a private army in Belize to murdering his neighbor. What happened? This is LGR Tech Tales, where we take a look at noteworthy stories of technological inspiration, failure, and everything in between. This episode tells the tale McAfee's antivirus software and its eccentric creator, John McAfee. Despite being born on a U.S. Army base in England in 1946, John David McAfee soon moved with his family to a house in Roanoke, Virginia in the United States. Growing up there wasn't easy by any means, with his alcoholic father frequently beating him and his mother, and then committing suicide when John was 15 years old. Soon after,
will you have me make a sound? Yeah. Bobblehead dogs. Dapat malagyan ng rings ang tatlong bobblehead dogs para magkaroon ka ng Out Out Award. Ang huling makakagawa challenge ang ma-eliminate.
Julian, gusto ko palitan natin. Balikan natin yung alaala at yung nanalo ka ng budget. Diba yung mga reaksyon yan eh? Yung mga samot-samot reaksyon yan pag nanalo yung mga budget. So Julian, I'm gonna announce ko.
And the winner of this pageant 2019, we have Judith! So now, winning, kinuong din to win it, 2019, Ray Fernandez!
Alam mo na ba nalulat mo? Budget ba? Boxing ba?
But of course, and finish up, the legend, the institution, Mr. Ray to win it, Epi, he's on!
Starting here with this movie as its fans as this is. Sit down. I think it's nice. Finally, it's totally arrested. It's crazy. Pink up meat in the afternoon and see the rest of the attribution. This film sees humanity on its last execution to DC. As the only survivor of the spectacle and the final stand against the undead gods, Alice must return to her nightmare again. Miraculous City.
Patrol, susunod na! Gabi, hawak nito ang kapalaman. nalangin siya sa iyong house.
Masusunod at pagpapakabi ko ng date house rin sa harap ang luminasyon.
Gusto ko lang umbalik sa housemate na ito.
Nakakasakit na yung mga salita na sinasabi mo. Nagiging immature siya.
Makasarin ko ito.
Nakakabastos na. Hindi niya naiisip niya na ang daman ng iba.
Ang tima ng maraming black circle ay automatically luminasyon.
Ang alagang anggap, alagang pang senior citizen, wala discount, hanggang mga benepisyo. Kaya mga data, alagang anggap. Kaya para sa aming mga hero,
para sa'yo,
cut. Don't bounce that end, you have a minute. Good luck, bro.
Sa maligang-gaw ang sunod na putok ng bariye. Dumiretso mga pulis sa eskinita. Ayon sa mga pulis, nagpaputok ang arrest ni isa namin ng si alias Dodo. Pumunagta si Dodo. At bumagsak rin sa tabi niya si Jeffrey Comendador, alias Jerome, na nakipagbarilan din naman sa mga pulis.
Una po kasi pinutukan yung pagkasama namin dito sa ano. Talagang lalaban ko.
Nakatakas naman ang kasama ng dalawa na lumusot sa isang eskinita. Lumalabas na nasa drug matrix ng Ermita Police si alias Dodo. Habang may kasong illegal possession of firearms at robbery si Jeffrey. Bagamat nakatakas sa isang suspect, naniniwala ang Manila Police na nagtatagulang siya sa 64 na hektaryang lupa dito sa Baseco compound kahit patuloy ang follow-up operation ng mga police. Zian Ambrosio, ABS-CBN News.
Si
Pinaghanap ngayon ang isang notorious na holdupper na tinutukan pa ng baril sa mukha ang biktimang babae sa Parañaque City. Exclusive na Papa Troll, Jerome Lantin.
Sa kuha ng CCTV ng Barangay Baclaran, Parañaque, mag-aalas 2 sa madaling araw nitong Biyernes, makikita isang lalaking nakasuot ng t-shirt, shorts at may dalambag na nakatambay sa kabaan ng Airport Road. Tila hindi mapakali ang lalaki at patingin-tingin sa paligid. Maya-maya, nakita niya ang dalawang babaeng naglalakad. Mabilis tumawid ang kalsada ng lalaki at biglang hinarang ang mga babae. Sa takot, mabilis nakatakbo ang isang babae pero na-corner ng suspect ang kasama nito. Hindi na nakapalag ang biktima, natutukan siya ng baril sa mukha ng suspect. Maging ang mga pasahero ng humintong jeep, walang nagawa dahil tinutukan rin sila ng baril. Kaswal na naglakad palayo ang suspect na parang walang nangyari. Nabangay ang cellphone, pera at iba pang mahalagang gamit ng biktimang si Diana. Kwento ng kasama niya si Jessica, papasok na sila sa trabaho sa Terminal 4 ng Laia nang harangin ang suspect.
Kaso kasi ay nga kami. So hindi namin napansin na may makakasalubong kami or what kasi nga kung maliliit na kami. Kaya na lang kung may kumarap sa amin na lang. Nung pagkakasubo ko, nakita ko meron siyang baril na hawak na nakatutok agad dun sa kasama ko.
Itong lugar na ito na boundary ng Parañaque at saka Pasay, lagi ito meron checkpoint operation. Kaya nung that time, meron silang ibang operation. Nire-review natin itong CCTV gallery. Makauha tayo ng lead.
Kinapahanap ko na sa ating mga operatiba. Inoblihan na natin pagbabantay.
Nanawagan naman ang Parañaque Police na ipagbigay alam sa kanila ang anumang impormasyon sa suspect. Jerome Lantin, ABS-CBN.
Lumantad na ang nagpakilalang si alias Bicoy na nasa likod ng video na nag-uugnay sa pamilya ni Pangulong Rodrigo Duterte sa droga. Ayon sa kanya, magsasampa siya ng reklamo at handa rin magpaibisiga tungkol sa akusasyon. Nagpapatrol, Nico Bawa.
Ay tunay na tao.
Sa isang press conference kanina, humarap ang nagpapakilalang alias Bicoy si Peter Zomel at Dingkula. Humihingi siya ng tulong sa Integrated Bar of the Philippines para kasuhan ang mga personalidad na itinukoy niya sa kanyang video tungkol sa droga.
Kailangan ko ng abogado para itugmit ang aking sinumpaang kalaytay at tulungan akong magsampa ng kaso laban sa mga miyembro ng sindikato na pinangalanan ko sa pidyusaryeng ang totoong nagulit. Ito'y pinamumunahan ni na Paolo Duterte, Christopher Lawrence Bong Sitoroco, Manasseh Carpio, na asawa ni Mayor Sara Duterte, ng Davao Group, at ang buong Cuadrangle Group.
Nilinaw niya na wala sa kinalaman sa oposisyon.
Na wala pong kaugnayan sa kahit kaninong kandidato. Lalo na sa mga kandidato ng 8 diretso o anumang political party o political affiliator. Wala din akong kaugnayan sa mga media personality at institusyon na pinangalanan ni Pangulong Duterte sa kanyang maitri.
Ang daraw sa humarap sa investigasyon.
Nagdesisyong akong lumabas dahil una, merong banta sa aking buhay. Ikalawa, tawag ng proseso. Nakikita ko ang pagwasak ng pamilya na dulot ng droga, na kung saan naging bahagi ako sa pagpapakalat ito noong membro pa ako ng sindikato.
Ayon sa kanya, naging empleyado siya ng Filipino Chinese businesswoman si Teresa Raniola na kasabot din daw sa droga.
Noong Febrero 2010, inilipat ako ng aking post na si Teresa Tess Raniola sa operation center ng sindikato bilang control man ng radio base at CCTV operation ng Central House Facility.
Pero itinanggi ito ni Raniola na nauna nang nagreklamo laban kay alias Bicoy sa FBI.
Wala po akong naging empleyadong lalaki. Kung alam niya, doon siya nagkamali.
Ayon din, kaya Dingkula, hindi niya kilala ang inarestong si Roden. Ay may nagkumawa ng website. Sa ang lumabas ang Bicoy, tinuro niya nag-upload ng video na si Maru Nguyenyes.
Makipagtulungan ka sana para kung pala nang wala naman isang ginawa, kaya parehas natin malinis ang ating mga pangalan.
Kanina, sinabi ng DOJ na sasampakan ng kasong inciting to sedition si Jaime. Isasampa ang kaso sa korte sa Parañaque bukas. Balak naman ng NBI Cybercrime Division na imbitahan siya rin na para makinggan ng kalaysay. Nangako ang IDC na bibigyan nila ng legal aid si Adingkula. Nico Bawa, ABS-CBN.
Para naman kay Justice Secretary Leonardo Guevara, dapat ay magsampa ng kaupulang kaso si Bicol kung may sapat siyang ebidensya laban sa mga bilanggit niya sa kanyang salaysay. Ayon naman kay Bongo, matagal na nang sinagot ang kasatid, partikular sa isyu ng tato. Dagdag pa nito, ipagpapatuloy nila ni Pangulong Duterte ang kanyang kampanya kontra droga, maging sino man umano ang masalasahan.
Pinagot ko niya noon, sabi ko ang meron sa akin likod yung TSM, BB, Simple, Redmark, Nunal, Balat at BBM. Ngayon na po, nagkamali po si Dito'y ng kanyang pinuntahan. Hindi po siya dapat pumunta sa IDP. Huwag po kayong mag-alala, protection na naman kayo ng gobyerno. Hindi dapat po muna sa tingin ko, magpapalimit muna siya sa mental hospital. Dapat mawala muna siyang pumunta rin.
Inasa ang tataas ang presyo ng mga imported na karne sa susunod na mga buwan. Apektado po kasi ng African swine fever. Aman sa China na pinakamalaking ito. Ayon sa Medium Border and Traders Association, dahil dito, binibili ng China ang lahat tenga, sisig at atay ng baboy. Pero sa taso ko ng demand sa China, apektado na rin maging ang ibang karne dahil ng manok, baka o paka ay iba pang alternatibo sa karne ng baboy. Ayon naman sa Department of Agriculture, magandang pagkakataon ang pagtaas ng presyo ng imported na karne para sa mga lokal na hog raisers. Bukod dito,